Hello everybody, welcome to another video of Reinaldo Chess Lesson. Today we are going to be talking about the top three shortest defeat ever. And for that, we are going to analyze some Masters games played by some of the best chess players in the world that they lose again in only a few moves. Let's start. The first game to analyze is a game played between Alonso Zapata and Vichy Anand. We were talking about this game in the video about my chess coach, the first part, where my coach, José Sequeira Paulini, managed to defeat the Colombian grandmaster, Alonso Zapata. But in this game, Alonso Zapata is really the protagonist of the game, defeating an ex-world champion in only a few moves. About this topic, you know, when we lose some games in such a way, we may have a lot of negative feelings, thinking that we are the unit in play those kind of blunders. But maybe, okay, as a kind of consolation for you, well, those games demonstrate that even the best chess player in the world are not the section for those kind of mistakes. And also they may lose some games in only a few moves or miniature. So, well, for this game, Alonso Zapata was playing with white pieces and he opened the game with e4. Well, Vichy Anand have the honor of being the protagonist of the shortest defeat. This is the shortest ever, really, at high level. This game was played in Biel in 1988. So, well, if I knight f3, knight f6, Petrov defense, knight takes d6, knight takes on e4, and here knight c3. This is known as the Ninsovich attack. Recently, it's a quite trending variant in those days. And black here, bishop make a blunder. He did bishop f5, okay, what really is a blunder? Because this move lose material immediately after queen e2. After this move, played by the Colombian grandmaster, Charles Vichy decides to resign because d3 is incoming and there is no way to stop that. So about this game, really there is a background. This game was played in 1988, but there is an older game where white, where black played the same move, but white didn't play queen e2. And that game was played between Anthony Miles and Larry Christensen. Those are two grandmasters. Anthony Miles is a British grandmaster who was very popular because he defeated Anatoly Karpov with starting the game after e4, a6. So let's look at the game. Okay, in this game, we have exactly the same opening. Anthony Miles was playing with white and Larry Christensen with black. After the Ninsovich attack, here we have the blunder, but instead of queen e2, pinning the knight and winning the pieces of the on the spot after d3, here, white just play knight takes on e4, allowing the trade of the pieces, and with this symmetrical position, everything was straight through the unique open file. So going back to the previous game, well, we have some advice, okay, about this position that, you know, if somebody played the same variant before, you have to investigate if this is playable or not, even despite the reputation of the player. You know, anything can substitute your homework. And apart from that, if the e file is open and your king is in the middle, be careful because your pieces can be pinned, like in this case. So this is the first game of the top three games, Alonso Zapata versus Vichy Anand. Let's go to the second one. In the second game, we have the protagonists of these players where Larry Christensen from United States versus Anatoly Karpov. Karpov was playing with black pieces. White opened with d4. After knight f6, c46, we have the Ninso-Indian defense. Knight f3, the anti-Ninso-Indian, preventing the pin on b4. Here, Karpov did b6, selecting the queen's Indian defense. This defense was the preference by Karpov. And here, Larry did a3. This is known as the Petrosian variation. Really, the idea of the move is be able to develop knight c3, preventing some pin on b4, and together with the queen, the knight can support some advance to d5 in order to block the diagonal for this bishop. For that reason here, white, black play bishop a6, attacking the pawn, in order to provoke this move, queen c2, because now the bishop can come back to b7. The point of this maneuver to force the queen to go to c2 is be able to prevent some d5, because now the queen on d1 is not supporting the advance of the pawn after the inclusion of some knight c3 move. Is the maneuver seems to be a little bit strange, but it's quite logical. And also, black wants to strike in the center with c5, putting pressure on d4, and without the queen on d1, that pawn can be more vulnerable. So white continue with knight c3, c5, e4, pawn takes, knight. So far, we have a Maroxivine structure with these two pawns on e4 and c4, and really the position looks more similar with a Sicilian defense. Knight c6. Here, important to mention, if black wants to kick the position in more similar with a kind of Sicilian setup, probably this move can be considered in order to enable the d7 square for the knight. But okay, black did knight c6, knight takes, bishop takes, bishop f4. Here, knight h5, chasing the bishop. This move is not so typical in the opening, especially considering if the bishop can go back somewhere. For example, here, some move like normal developed move, for example, like bishop c5 is also quite good, and also a6 to prevent some knight b5 jumps, creating the intersection pawn on d6. But okay, knight h5, bishop e3, and here we are going to see the blunder played by Anatoly Karpov in move 11, losing the game on the spot. Here he did, the theoretical variant is queen b8, but, you know, sometimes we are in the game, we start to think in a move, probably thinking that can be an interesting novelty, okay? And after bishop d6, this is a blunder, because after this maneuver with knight h5, the knight is hanging in the edge of the board. And here, Karpov missed a very simple move, but difficult to spot because it's a backward move. Now, Larry did queen d1, short backward move, attacking the bishop and the knight hanging. And after this, it's just a fork and game over, and Karpov decided to resign the game in only 2 hours. So about the learning of these games, okay, be careful, unprotected pieces can be tactical motive, like the knight in the edge of the board. And also, well, the double attack or the fork is a usual tactical tool to take advantage of this. Okay, this was the second game. Let's go for the third one. The third one is the oldest one. This was a game played in Vienna in 1872 by the ex-world champion, first official world champion, Wilhelm Steinitz. Steinitz was playing as black against Walter Grinshaw. Walter opened the game with e4, and after e5, knight f3, knight c6, we have the squash opening, and here Steinitz did queen h4. Okay, this is known as the Steinitz variation in the squash game, so we have the creator of the variant giving a try to his idea. Objectively speaking, this variant is considering dubious, but interesting to try to catch the opponent unprepared. Normally, the main downside of the move is that the pawn on c7 is unprotected, and for that reason, the main move here used to be knight b5, highlighting the main weakness created after the last move of the opponent. Okay, but this move sacrificed a pawn, and here, white did a kind of silent. He blocked the check with the bishop. Normally, we would like to block the check with the kingside pieces to try to castle as soon as possible. About the pawn hanging, we shouldn't be worried about this, because after bishop f3, we have a double attack winning on the spot. So, bishop e3 was the move played in the game. But in case of bishop e2, just to understand later the blunders played by Steinitz, because really he just followed the main variant without being the main variant, because now white was using a silent during the game. But in case of bishop d2, the typical way to continue is bishop b4 check, attacking the king and hoping to do something like after c3, bishop a5. It's a common maneuver to protect the pawn that is not defended by the queen. But okay, after the check, the normal variant can continue with bishop d2, and king d8 is a necessary move to protect the pawn. So black have an extra pawn, but lose the right to castle with the queens on the board, really, if I would have to select one pieces to play, I would prefer white pieces here. So considering this, also important to mention that in this moment, for example, a move like instead of bishop b4, a move like queen e5 that was a move played in the game, but with the bishop on e3, not with the bishop on e2. In this specific circumstance, the move is a blunder because after f4, both squares are covered and the queen cannot be defending the pawn on c7. So let's go back to the game. Walter did bishop e3, blocking the check. And here, the best move is queen e5 to protect the pawn in this way. Now, f4 is not possible because the bishop on e3 will be hanging. That's the difference. But here, Steyn is continuing with the same move in the main variant. Against bishop e2, the main move is bishop b4. But in this specific position, this move is a blunder because now white can simply block the check with the knight. Now, the pawn is under attack and the queen is under attack. This trade is more or less forced. And after queen takes king d8, now the position is completely different in comparison with the other circumstances because here white is ready to castle long and have the bishop pair with some central open lines towards the king. Right now, just to let you know, the valuation of the computer is almost plus 5, exactly plus 4.5. So, well, white did long castle, big advantage in development, and bishop pair. Only the bishop pair sometimes can compensate a pawn of this advantage, imagine with such development. So queen e6, anticipating bishop d3, bishop f4. Okay, this create intersection point, keeping the initiative, black block, and now we have here the sacrifice. Bishop takes on d6. Normally, if we want to do a sacrifice, usually it's good to start with the less valuable pieces. Here, the top move suggested by the engine is knight takes on c7, but this is good, preparing the discovery attack with the knight. Now here in the game, black did queen a2, and this allows a beautiful checkmate in 6 move. Move number 12, like Karpov in the previous game. Steyn is already busted. Another alternative here, instead of queen takes on a2, could be queen c7, but after this, bishop c4, creating another intersection point on f7, and after the capture there with the knight, the rook will be dragged on the corner. So Steyn is just captured following kind of the speeding of the position, but now the finish of the game was this knight b5 check, king to e8, knight c7 check, king to f8, and queen d6 check, provoking knight g7, and now there is some background issues because all the squares are covered. White sacrifice the queen, black is forced to capture, and we have here the check. Really, in the game, Steyn didn't allow the checkmate. He just resigned after queen d6 check because the checkmate is unavoidable after the block and white getting the back. So, well, guys, with this, we finish with the analysis of the shortest defeat ever in chess, played by one of the best chess players in the world. So if you make those kind of blunders in your games, even in the opening phase, don't feel so bad. This happens. We have to work just to reduce the frequency of this. Oh, I forgot to mention, well, about this game, the main learning is don't play a stereotypical move. You know, try to calculate always. Anything can substitute the calculation. Sometimes when we don't have any kind of theoretical knowledge, that can be beneficial because we are kind of forced to calculate and to verify with our eyes what's going on over there. So, well, I hope you enjoyed the video. Don't forget, if you enjoy this kind of content, you have a lot of options to support the channel. Don't forget like, subscribe, share with your friends, and hope to see you in a new video. Check the next video in the list.